I'm Mary Embleton. I'm Executive Director of Cascade Harvest Coalition, and I would like to welcome you all to the first inaugural Pierce County Farm Forum. It's really amazing to see such a packed room of folks that are, there's a lot of energy in this room, and hopefully it's my job today to keep us on track, because we've got just a tremendous panels of speakers and ag support people that are here, all in hopes of helping build a really strong, vibrant food and farm community in Pierce County. I'm really honored to be asked to be here this afternoon. I've worked in local agriculture and sustainable ag issues for the last 17 years and started my career here in 1989 doing land and resource planning. So it's been interesting to watch the trajectory of what has happened in Pierce County over those years in terms of planning for land use and support of agriculture. And it's really inspiring right now to me to have an executive and a county council and other county ag programs that are here to support producers and to make sure that they can be successful and that you can have healthy communities here. The idea of the forum basically came out of you, as translated through the executive and the council and the ag program. They held a series of farm walks last year and tried to engage with a diversity of producers to find out what the opportunities and constraints were and what specific role the county could play in supporting that vibrant farm community. So this forum today is for all of you. We want to hear your comments. We want your feedback. It's very valuable as this whole process moves forward. So throughout the day, you can see that on your table, and I swipe one and I'll have to give it back to you guys over there. There's a number of cards, so as thoughts or questions arise, or if you have ideas or concerns, mark them down on these. There are also a series of white poster boards out in the foyer and on the tables in here, and pens are available, so, and they're categorized by specific areas, whether it's marketing or regulations or things like that. So if you have specific comments in those areas, please make sure that you note them down. There are a number of people in the audience in addition to producers, and we're kind of focusing on producers because that's the whole idea. Farmers have an orange band on the top of their name tags. So if you're looking to get connected, the rest of us just have white bands. We're technically ag support or others. So hopefully there's a couple of opportunities this afternoon to hook up with everybody. They will be identified in the PowerPoint presentation. So if you're looking for a specific type of ag support, look for those people. We'll have a break at about 4, and then we'll also have a brief networking session before dinner. So I encourage you strongly to search people out and engage and make those connections that you need to. Any event like this, of course, takes a ton of planning, and they want to pay particular thanks to WSU Extension, the Pierce Conservation District, and the Russell Family Foundation. So with that, I would like to introduce Dennis Hanberg, who is the Director of Planning and Land Services Agriculture Program. And he will go through the process of how we got here today, as well as how the county is laying the groundwork for the support that they want to provide to local producers. So with that, please welcome Dennis Hanberg.
All right, thank you, and welcome everyone to this first forum. I sure appreciate the opportunity to be here and kick things off. Planning and Land Services, what do we do? We're in charge of land use applications, permitting, building permits, and so on. But we also have the long-range planning side of the house, and we were fortunate enough on the long-range planning side to be involved in this agricultural initiative. So I want to thank you all for coming today and be part of our first forum. History-wise, I can only give you the last couple years' history, but I think it's actually been some of the most innovative and most encouraging. In late 2012, with guidance and leadership from Executive McCarthy and Council Chair McDonald, we got funding set aside, and that funding set aside was to support and develop an agricultural initiative that would recognize, promote, encourage, and preserve our agricultural farmlands and, of course, our farmers. Initial suggestions were that what we really needed was a farm ombudsman, somebody that could help with permitting and land use challenges. But that suggestion quickly morphed, and it morphed into what we think was a larger initiative and something that we hope provides more support. It was an initiative that created a program for expedited reviews and permitting that is in place, and Diane Marcus Jones is your contact to work through some of those land use issues if they come up. Continued work to simplify codes and regulations, work to streamline permitting between PALS, Planning and Land Services, the Health Department, who has representatives here today, and Surface Water Management, who also has representatives here today. We're trying to coordinate all of those efforts. We started a Meet the Farmer program, which you've seen some of the wonderful videos that PCTV has put together. Again, trying to introduce our farmers to our customers and the citizens of Pierce County. Created a new website, which you'll see and hear some more about later on today as well. And then we also did some farm tours, and the farm tours were just enjoyable and eye-opening at the same time. Great opportunities to learn about rhubarb. We learned about rhubarb on the local and East Coast markets for rhubarb. That was good. Raising sheep, starting a new farm from scratch, organic farming, and of course dozens of vegetable crops that come out of our valley. It's just, to be a citizen for so many years and not realize what we have out there for a resource was just a wonderful eye-opening experience. And all of that was growing in Pierce County. It was just a wonderful experience. And of course, we started this forum to advance and promote ideas and discussions that we hope will benefit everyone in this room. None of this would have been possible without the active, and I mean active, support of Pat McCarthy and Joyce McDonald. They've been with us every step of the way, asking for check-ins, coming to our meetings, really getting involved and rolling their sleeves up, and of course, going on those farm tours and meeting with many of you along the way. Our executive, Pat McCarthy, is just starting her sixth year. Her leadership has promoted many improvements in our government offices and efficiencies and challenges to do more with less, myself included. She challenges us on a daily basis to combine new tools, technology, and process improvements into what is becoming a highly and quality efficient program delivery system. Above all, her biggest emphasis has been on customer service, and that's what we're doing at Planning Land Services to hopefully provide that customer service to you as well. Councilmember Joyce McDonald is a highly experienced and motivational leader who's represented the Puyallup Valley in our agricultural endeavors for many years. Joyce has provided key leadership and direction in our work to improve county codes and efficiencies, also legislative policies, and most important, has helped with much needed funding to keep our program going and really get this started again. Joyce has served the last 2 years as council chair and is now as the executive pro tem. It's now my pleasure to introduce both Pat and Joyce to speak further on our agricultural initiatives in the outreach and really kick off our day. So thank you very much.
Great. Thank you, Ben. Thank you. Thank you. And to all the farmers who are in this audience, thank you for coming. This is all about you. You brought us here. You brought us together. So I want to thank you on behalf of the team that's worked so very hard to make this a reality. It's so exciting to see a packed room because we want the agricultural industry to thrive, not to survive, but to thrive. And we are a little squeezed in here today. This is our first farm forum. We knew there would be a lot of interest, but we didn't necessarily know whether you would be able to come because you're all very busy people. And so we weren't sure how many to expect, but we're excited to know that there are about 110 of us and 70 farmers, which is what this is all about. It's all about you, the farmers. As you'll see in a video in a few minutes, agriculture is an important part of Pierce County's past. And by working together and to share ideas and our expertise, it will continue to be an important part of our future. As I told the Farm Bureau a few months ago, there's a green sticker taped to the cabinet next to my desk that says, "No farms, no food." You can see the picture of it on the slideshow. That sticker occupies some really valuable real estate in my office because it's right next to a picture of one of my 9 grandchildren. The 4 words on that sticker sum it up nicely. No farms, no food. That's why one of my top priorities is to work with you and with others in the industry to help it thrive. We've revised some regulations. We're not quite finished with revising those regulations, those of you that are keeping us our feet to the fire. And we are pursuing partnerships with other agencies and organizations to discuss regulations and competing priorities. We've streamlined ag preservation policies so we can keep transferring or purchasing development rights. That enables you to realize the full value of your life's work without sacrificing that fertile land. You asked for help with marketing and promotion. This year, Pierce County is sponsoring marketing and advertising for farmers markets. We have made presentations to the Regional Food Policy Council, state legislators, the King Pierce Farm Bureau, and Pierce Tilth. We are using our resources at Pierce County TV to introduce consumers to you, our farmers, with our year-long series called Meet the Farmer. We created a video you'll see in a few moments that I think is just phenomenal. I hope you like it too, that showcases the history of farming in Pierce County and celebrates the people who will ensure its future. That video is being premiered today, so nobody else has seen it but a few of us. After today, we hope that you will help us share it with the community so they can learn more about local food options and the people who provide them. We are participating in ongoing research to expand existing markets and create niche markets. In a few minutes, you'll hear about one of our biggest innovations, a mobile app that puts the Puget Sound Fresh Farm Guide in your pocket. Soon, customers from all over Western Washington will be able to access lists of farms, farmers markets, local foods, recipes, and farm-related events, all from the push of a button on their smartphone or tablet. We are building this app for the Cascade Harvest Coalition through a partnership we have with the University of Washington, Tacoma. Under that partnership, we hired interns from the University Institute of Technology to build these mobile apps. This is a perfect example of what I'm talking about. 3 organizations, Pierce County, the Cascade Harvest Coalition, and UW-Tacoma, all working together to use technology to connect consumers with local farms. I strongly believe that supporting agriculture is an important part of Pierce County's economic development strategy. That's demonstrated by how many departments in Pierce County government are involved in our ag initiative. Planning and Land Services, Economic Development, Communications, Information Technology, the Office of Sustainability, and of course, the Office of the County Exec and the County Council. I'm excited about the prospects for the ag industry in Pierce County. One of the reasons I'm confident we'll be successful is because you have a lot of advocates. One of them is my friend and colleague, Joyce McDonald. Joyce was a great partner during her 2 years as chair of the Pierce County Council. This issue is very important to Joyce and to her district. I will continue to work with Joyce as well as new council members and new council chair, Dan Roach, who's here today as well, and others on the county council. I see Rick Talbert's here, and I think Joyce is going to introduce them, and our cities and towns to identify solutions to the challenges that you face. So please join me in welcoming Joyce McDonald to share more about Pierce County's commitment to agriculture.
Thank you, Pat. And it's really great to be here with all of you. And I do know that Councilmember Rick Talbert is here. Rick, could you stand up? And right behind Rick is Councilmember, our new chair of the Pierce County Council, Dan Roach. Thank you so much for being here. And if it wasn't for the support of the other members on the Pierce County Council, we probably wouldn't be here today. But they understand, just like the executive does, no farms, no food. So I'd like to start by sharing a really big number. Our Economic Development Department calculates that farming generates $100 million in sales each year in Pierce County. That's right, $100 million in sales. And I think that we don't realize that or give as much importance to that number as we really should. It's abundantly clear that healthy, thriving farms are good for business and good for our community. I'm proud to represent the Puyallup Valley, among other places in my district, but I want you to know that I have visited farms all over the county, including out in the Key Peninsula, and it's a proud and valuable industry, and we're determined to make sure that it stays that way. Our Ag Initiative is designed to serve as that strategic plan that encourages businesses to grow. For example, one task, as the executive said, and it's a challenge, is to simplify and streamline the regulations that concern our land, water, air, and buildings. And we think that we can do it well while still doing it right. We know how difficult it is because there are multiple layers of regulations from multiple agencies that farmers have to deal with every day. We need to make sure that those regulations are not so burdensome that they serve as barriers to your growth. In recent years, we've seen a growing interest from consumers who want to know where their food is coming from. Increasingly, they're realizing that local farmers make for a healthier, more connected community. And not surprisingly then, when I ask farmers and ranchers what else we can do to help, most of them say they'd appreciate assistance in marketing their products. We're using our website, social media platforms, Pierce County TV, and even the bulletin boards in the county courthouse to promote local farms and products, thanks to our executive. She really does follow through with some of these ideas, and I'm encouraged by that. And in recent months, we've promoted pumpkin patches, Christmas tree farms, and other things on our county webpage. But as Pat said, you're about to get a sneak peek at a very cool mobile app. And still, even with all the things that we want to do, we know we can't do it alone. So we've got important partnerships with the WSU Extension, Pierce Conservation District, King Pierce Farm Bureau, Puget Sound Regional Council, and more. And this farm forum is just one step, hopefully today, in the right direction. So today we'll hear from local experts, as well as some from around the state, and they'll talk about ways to access new markets and new customers. Because we all know that when a business doesn't have a customer, they don't have a business. So I hope you'll learn ways to diversify your markets and discover ways to reach customers who want your products but just don't know how to get them. We're optimistic about our prospects for success, and that's why the theme today for this farm forum is New Horizons for Pierce County. There are opportunities out there for agricultural businesses, and we're poised to help. We're not perfect, but we're poised to help. And working together, we want to help our local farmers succeed. So we're just about ready to get to the meat of today's farm forum, but before we do, as Pat said, our communications department has created a special video for you, and it reminds us of just how far we've come. And as you will see, it shows there's plenty of reason for optimism about the future of farming in Pierce County. Thank you for your hard work. Thank you for the opportunity to be here. Enjoy the video.
Look at their faces. They're weathered and dirty. They look tired, but they are content. It's the unmistakable mark of a farmer's resiliency and determination. Mount Rainier laid the foundation for the fertile soils of Pierce County. In its shadow, a rich farming history began with the Hudson's Bay Company building Fort Nisqually in 1833. More settlers arrived in the 1850s and started their own farms countywide under the Donation Land Claim Act. In 1882, the hops industry boomed in Puyallup, thriving when the European harvest failed. Hops grew well in the rich valley soil. Farmers like Ezra Meeker made fortunes, which would be all but lost within a decade when an aphid infestation caused the hop blight.
My great-grandfather nearly made a million and lost it all, you know, because the hop market was so volatile. And then kind of transitioned and started growing rhubarb, rhubarb is probably the one item that's kind of remained, you know, with some long, long history.
In the early 1900s, rhubarb farming began. This is a crate label from 1931, when the Sumner Rhubarb Growers Association opened its new bulb and rhubarb warehouse. That year, they would ship 25 rail cars of field rhubarb and 110 rail cars of hothouse rhubarb. To this day, a quarter of the nation's acres growing rhubarb are right here in Pierce County. In 1910, George Lawler planted the first daffodil bulb farm near Fife. 2,000 bulbs launched the daffodil industry. Because daffodils were grown for their bulbs, not the flowers, the now famous Daffodil Festival and Grand Floral Street Parade began in 1934 to use the flowers that were being discarded. Some people are born into farming, or hard lessons working the land passed down from generation to generation. Fourth and fifth generation father and son, Tim and Timothy Richter, work side by side.
Having him be a part of the farm and seeing him every day, we have our days where we don't really want to see each other, but you know, it's really good that it keeps us close.
Some people love the soil and want to depend on their own hands to make a living.
It's the most honest work that I can find. It's, you know, certainly as real as it comes to be able to take something from seed, produce it, and feed somebody with that.
And others marry into the land.
I wasn't too surprised. It's just that I didn't know what I was getting into.
Berries have been a bumper crop. Look at the height of those raspberry bushes in this 1929 photo.
My grandma Schultz sold berries on the side of the road. Well, now we got like 14,000 cars a day going by. And a lot of people think that's traffic, you know, and we kind of kid around and say that they're customers.
Just as previous generations of farmers learned to adapt and change.
You've got to have a very, very consistent supply. You know, running out doesn't happen anymore. You have to find a way to fill orders.
Today's farmers also face new challenges.
When I plant something, I already know I got a home for it.
Almost done.
In 1940, the average size of a Pierce County farm was 28 acres. By 1959, it had grown to 60 acres. But by 2007, that number had dropped off to just 33.
This day and age, with smaller pieces of land, you really need to diversify if you're going to really be able to survive as a farmer.
Finding a new crop of farmers is vital to the industry's survival. Rallying support from seasoned neighbors and the community makes it easier to weather the difficult days.
Everybody's been great. If I need something, they're there. If I need help, they're there. If I'm looking for knowledge, they're willing to share it.
Because getting a new farm up and running is hard.
We didn't expect to have headlamps on at night harvesting carrots, and there's just a lot when it's just the family.
One of the many challenges to the future of farming in Pierce County is land preservation, protecting in perpetuity the fertile soil that we've farmed for nearly 200 years. When Emma Ford's husband passed away and their 100-acre dairy closed in Ording, she couldn't stand the idea of that land covered in housing.
Well, my husband loved that piece of property, but I've got to believe that this is what was meant to be, and this is the way he would have wanted me to do it, and that's all I can hold on to.
Now, three new farmers work that historic Ford property.
If we don't preserve this farmland, if we don't take action, where are we going to be when we really need to feel comfortable with our food security?
The Pierce County Executive's Agriculture Initiative is proactively helping farmers. We want them to stay here and prosper. The industry also gives a vital boost to the economy, bringing in $100 million in sales annually.
I think what's really important for us in Pierce County is to be able to make sure that we put farming and farmland in a place where it can be economically viable.
The county actively helps by providing permitting assistance, promoting local products, and educating consumers. We all play a role in the long-term success of local farms.
Well, I would like them to be more aware of where their food comes from and to shop more often at their local farmers markets and at their local farm stores. Our farm stores open year-round.
Talk with farmers about what fuels them, and you feel their passion.
It's the grueling work, and then you get to the market and everybody's happy to accept your produce. You have return customers that come back that are the best. Gotta have those beets. Sanford's beets are the ones we want, and they come back to every single market to buy those.
We'll see you next Friday.
That's what really gives me the fuel to keep pushing forward and trying new things, creating new products.
A passion to work the land, to be the legacy.
We're going to plant more of this, and we're even going to have a better year. And I guess it's kind of an addiction in that sense that, you know, next year's going to be even better. You know, it's kind of like gambling, you know. You just kind of get a little fever for it, and planting stuff is that same way.
Look at these faces. They are the future of farming in Pierce County. Because of them, agriculture will continue to prosper.
Good afternoon. My name's Hunter George. I'm the communications director for Pierce County. I'd like to say before I start with this next part, my team, Pierce County TV, produced that video, and it was a lot of fun. They had a great time. We had a lot of fun interviewing Emma Ford. The Richters are great. There are some great stories to tell in this county, and we're having a lot of fun doing it, so I appreciate that. This video, again, we showed it to you first. Now we're going to make it public. We're going to air it on PCTV, which is on channel 22. I'm going to put it on the county's website. I'm going to put it on the county's Facebook page. If you all, for all of you, for the farms that have Facebook pages, please share it. We'll make sure that that you know about it and have access to it. And so we'd love to see that some more. From one piece of technology to another, my friend Cheryl Weiser and I are here to talk to you about the farm app. That we've been working on in partnership, the county and Cascade Harvest Coalition. So Cheryl's going to start and talk to you about Puget Sound Fresh, and then I'm going to show you. The app isn't live yet, so you're going to get a sneak peek at it today.
Hi, everybody. I think there's a few people in this room that I know. I'm Cheryl Weiser. I'm the communications manager with Cascade Harvest Coalition. I also manage our Puget Sound Fresh program. And just in a nutshell, in case you don't know, Cascade Harvest Coalition, we connect farmers to farmers to markets, and farmers to eaters. So farmers to farmers is how we help farmers find farmland. Farmers to markets is how we help work with farmers and connect them with new markets for their products. And farmers to eaters is our Puget Sound Fresh program. And that is all about community, and that is about content, that is about education, and we do that through our farm guide. I think a few of you know this publication, and our Puget Sound Fresh program. So in a nutshell, between August 2012 and August 2013, there were over 500,000 visits to the Puget Sound Fresh website. Okay, and so our goal with that website and with that program, it's not just about how people can find their food. They need to be able to connect to each and every farmer, to your story, how you grow your food, everything that you saw in the video. All of those stories, all of that emotion, all of that passion, all of that hard work. People need to know about that, and they need to know about their food. They need to know about everything that you do. And so that's our job. Our job is to get that information out there, whether it's in the guide or it's with the app, and we have all the different products that people can search by. I think you can see the data. So we're just going to kind of move ahead, but we are thrilled to have this partnership. I want to thank each and every one of you for being here today.
So at the county, we have a terrific program. Our information technology department has a partnership with the University of Washington Tacoma's Institute of Technology. We bring in two interns every 6 months, and they build mobile apps for us. So the IT director came to me back in the last summer and said, I've got interns here. I need a project. And the week before, I had just had a meeting with PALS. This was after one of the farm tours, I believe, that the executive and Joyce, McDonald, and others had gone on, and they'd come back and said, you know, they want marketing help. And so, you know, a week later, I've got IT in my office saying, we want to build something. And I was thinking about my wife and her friends and the conversations I've heard them have about their interest, their growing interest in local produce. They've given up on some of the grocery stores. They want it local. They want it right out of the earth. So I said to IT, well, why don't we see if we could build some kind of app that would connect consumers with local produce. So we looked around. Cascade Harvest Coalition was the obvious partner. So we called them. I think Cheryl thinks that we're a gift from heaven. Because we called them up and said, hey, we have the resources to build this tool. You have all of this data. Why don't we get together and partner on this thing? So that's what we're doing. So you'll the app is going to be on both of the major platforms, iOS, which are your Apple devices, iPhones and iPads. It will be on Android as well. We hope that you will tell your customers about it, as well as your family and your friends. We expect it should be live by early April, which is when the 2014 Farm Guide hits the streets. So right around the same time, you've got a print guide and you've got a digital version in your pocket wherever you are. So now let's show them this first page. These are two variations of the home page. We've structured it so that the colors, that background image, is going to change with the seasons. So that one on your left is the fall, and the one on the right is the winter. It gets a lot greener in the spring and summer. And as you can see, we've isolated six major categories of data. At the push of one button, you can go to a list of local farms. You can go to local farmers markets. There's a harvest schedule. There's a list of products. They have a lot of recipes, which is, I've had fun looking through those, and farm-related events. Let's go to the next slide. So again, now we're drilling in. If you clicked on farms, on the left there, you'll see it's a GPS map. It knows where you are. And again, the Cascade Harvest covers at least 12 counties.
No, actually, we are now statewide.
Statewide.
Puget Sound Fresh is now statewide.
When we started this project, there were 12 counties, and now they're much, much bigger. So wherever you are, your phone will know and will give you the closest farms that are in their database. And then the same thing with the farmers market. So same concept. We put them under different colors just so people can kind of remember where they are. Let's do the next slide. Again, remember I showed you from the homepage. If you click on harvest schedule on the left there, you can see it's interactive. You can swipe through it and see in various months this is what's available. I hear people ask that question. You know, I'm looking for blueberries. Is this the season or not? We can show them again right there on their phone and make it really easy. The recipes. This was one of the ones that caught my eye, so I did a screen grab of it. I love breakfast. next slide. And then finally, this is the last preview here. If you've noticed, when we were looking at farms and when we were looking at markets, there was a star next to it, and some of them were gold and some weren't. You're able to tag your favorites. And so it went, once you tag your favorites, that's what that slide on the left shows you. And there are three tabs. The screen grab that I got is farms, and so I just tagged some local farms in Pierce County. If I touched markets, it would give me my favorite markets, and same with recipes. So we give people an ability to kind of bookmark their favorites. And then the product list is amazing. This lady here has built an incredible list. This database is really amazing. It's got hundreds of items on there. And again, if you can't find it, it doesn't exist, I think, if it's not on this list. So we're really excited about it. Again, it hasn't launched yet, and I can't give you a firm date. If anybody, there's one friend of mine in the room who does this kind of stuff, and he knows it's hard to put dates on these kinds of things. We're still working some things out, but we do anticipate it will be live by early April. I would anticipate a significant marketing push on the partners' behalf, and we're looking for your help. We've built this to get customers to come to you. So anything you can do, we will be creating posters, we'll do social media posts, we'll do a PCTV video. We're gonna have a lot of what we call collateral to get the word out, and anything you can do to help share that with your customers helps everybody in the room. So thank you very much.
So now that we're kind of reconvening to this, we're going to start our first panel. I just want to remind you again that your input is really critically important to everything, not only that you've heard, but as the county moves forward. They want to be here for you. They want to be here to support you and a viable, thriving farm economy. So make sure that you get your notes, comments. Pardon? Oh, okay. Nah. Written down on the table or on the white sheets out on spread around this facility. I want to just take a brief second before I introduce the panel is that there are a number of upcoming events. that are supportive of local agriculture. There's an upcoming farm-to-table workshop that brings local producers together with local buyers. There's the Women in Agriculture Conference that's coming up. And then there's also some important legislation that's being proposed right now. Dick Karkner, come and give you half a minute, or you can you think you can talk loud enough from there? It's health insurance for farmers and migrant farm workers.
Thanks. This will just, you can hear me now? Okay, this will just take a minute. I'd just like to encourage those who are interested in signing up for health care. Materials are on the table out here in English and Spanish. And related to that is a bill that's going through the legislature right now. It's just moved out of the House and is moving through the process. This bill will allow coverage to extend to seasonal workers, farm workers. I know that's important to us as a farm employer. Others of you might also be interested. There is a petition on the table out there that you could sign to help support this. Key swing votes are Bruce Demere and also Randy Becker.
Okay, will you be out there at the break?
I will.
Okay, so let's
chat about that.
Look for Dick and the petition out in the hallway.
Okay.
At the break.
Thank you.
All right, thanks, Dick. Okay, marketing and growing thriving agriculture businesses in Pierce County. The first panel we have this afternoon is a great combination of both local producers and local ag experts that bring many years of successful marketing experience to this conversation in particular. The title of this panel is Thriving in a Dynamic Marketplace. How do you access new market opportunities, whether it's niche markets or conventional markets? We know that there's incredible consumer demand for local food products that far outstrips what's currently available in retail stores, as well as the whole broad spectrum of where we access food. We know there's increasing demand from institutions, schools, hospitals, prison facilities to source locally. How do we step up our game as producers and as support professionals in this industry to get you to access those markets in ways that are successful for you and benefit the community? So the panel we have today is we're going to break it out into two sessions. We're going to focus on the ag experts first, and they're going to bring their years of experience and tell you what they've discovered in terms of opportunities and challenges that they've been seeing in the marketplace. And then we'll bring some local producers to bear and see how they've basically navigated those opportunities and challenges to be successful. So on our first panel, I would like to invite up Don McMoran, who is the director of WSU Skagit County Extension, and Fred Berman, who is with the Northwest Agriculture Business Center. Many of you may have known Fred in his former life at WSDA. I pretty much had him on speed dial, so he's been an important part of our community.
As I was preparing for today's talk, I quickly jotted down some notes that I'd like to go forward and read from. And then as you have questions, feel free to interject along the way. So one of the first things that came to mind as I was thinking about this thriving in a dynamic marketplace is really about markets and getting your products to market. As I think of the traditional model and my great-grandfather, when he immigrated from Ireland to Skagit County and created dairy farm there, they're really reliant on somebody else marketing their products, right? So you would produce the milk, you'd put it in a can, and away it would go, and next thing you know, there's a milk check on your door. And that was a really great system. Times have changed dramatically in that system, in that, and I wrote here that being a farmer and relying on someone else to add value to your product and selling it is dead. But then I had to scratch that out because I ran into a teacher last night at the school, and he said, "Don, if I get 50 more cows on, I'm going to quit my job." And so he's one of these people that is still relying on this model of making a product and having somebody else sell that product. He's raising beef cows. He's selling it right to the auction barn, and he's almost ready to quit his day job to do that. So that was one of the thoughts that I had. The other thought is resources and think about the resources that we're blessed with in the Northwest. We have some of the best soils in the world, not in Washington State, not in the United States, but in the world. But at the same time, we can have farms farming the best soil in the world, and they cannot be economically sustainable. So that's the big picture here, is if you're not economically sustainable, your business is not going to succeed. The other thought I had was growing up on a farm, and a lot of the decisions that we made on our own farm, looking back now, that didn't make sense. And so my next quote is, run your farm like a business, not like an emotion. And I say this because a lot of those decisions where we would dump thousands of dollars into a piece of machinery that was maybe worth a few hundred dollars probably wasn't the best business decision, and later on that had an impact on what we did on our own farm, and probably why I'm before you today as your ag educator and not on a farm. I think, you know, personally, that was my goal growing up, to be a farmer. And this was occupation number two, if you will. The other thing is I have a friend, and he wanted to be a farmer. But his whole goal and the reason why he farmed was because he had land. And his quote to me was, well, we have all this land. I might as well be a farmer. Well, that's not taking business and the economically sustainable model and putting it forward. And that's why he didn't succeed as a farmer. He didn't build a business plan. Why did he get into farming? I have the land. Well, that's a really bad decision, okay? You need to have more behind what you're going to do as a farmer before you move forward into farming. So I also want to take a little bit historical perspective, and the video I thought was excellent, going back and modeling and showing us what was here on the landscape 100 years ago. And you actually have a greater history than what we have in Skagit County, going back 200 years ago. And my own personal perspective with my great-grandfather here immigrating to Skagit County. He bought 50 acres and a barn in 1909, and he paid $800 for that. So as I think about what his hurdles were, really there's four thoughts that come to mind. Number one is land. $800, if you do the inflation on it, works out to be about $1.5 million today. But during that time, was with a very nice barn, was inexpensive. The second is labor. Labor, during those times, you could hire a person to work a whole week for $40. The third is the regulations. There were none. They're non-existent. As a farmer, you did whatever you pleased, as you chose. And the fourth is the technology. And during those times, basically, there was no technology. You did everything with hand labor the same way that they did it hundreds of years before you. We'll step into today and see how those things have changed. We have land. Is land cheap or expensive? Very expensive. What about our labor? Also very expensive and also going up and going to be more expensive in the future. The third, regulation. More regulation, less regulation. Much more than 100 years ago. And the fourth is the game changer. And this is what's going to make you more successful in your farming operations, is the technology. We have access to more technology cheaper than anyone ever in history of mankind. I have a farmer that farms in Skagit County that just put in a robotic milker. Can you imagine? Doesn't touch a cow's udder at all. Not one person. A robot milks his cows. And the cows decide when they milk. Okay? These are the things that are going to make us successful so that we can get through the three hurdles before us, which are the expensive things. I also want to leave you with a quote, and this is from Dave Hedlund. He's one of the wonderful farmers in Skagit County that I get the opportunity to work with. Dave states, if you have one customer, you are a price taker. If you have thousands of customers, now you're a price maker. So as a farmer, be a price maker. And then I want to close with some of the struggles in which I had the opportunity to participate in with an incubator farm in Skagit County. It's one of the first ones within Western Washington, and it stemmed from the opportunity to teach a class called Cultivating Success. And from that class, having people come to me and say, Don, I love the class. I want to be a farmer. I want to farm in Skagit County. However, I don't have any access to land. And within that, me as an educator, as a farmer, being a problem solver, putting it to the community and say, we have a problem here. We need to resolve it. And from that, a foundation came forward. They made a large financial contribution, and we started the first incubator farm in Skagit County so that anybody, regardless of race or what have you, can come take some educational courses from WSU and then move forward and become a farmer on a small scale and then share resources, equipment, and the like. So from that, we learned a lot. Number one, there are a tremendous amount of great farmers out there, but many of them, especially our Latino population, have difficulty marketing their own products, and so that's where we started expanding Viva Farms. And it now has its own market stand, it has its own CSA, and they're doing sales upwards of $100,000 in the busy season months, and they're going great guns. So that has skyrocketed, and unfortunately, because of my director position, I'm no longer a part of it, but it was a great thing to put on the ground and move forward. So I want to finish out with thinking about your marketplace, thinking about where your access is. You have some tremendous potential here in Pierce County because of your proximity to population, but you also have to think about your customer. This isn't the customer that's looking for the best deal at the biggest box store. You have to access the customer who wants to pay the extra price and the premium to be a part of you. And I think a lot about yesterday and having 700,000 people in Seattle. What did the Seattle Seahawks do to get 700,000 people to come to their doorstep? They created marketing, right? They made you all 12s. You're a part of their organization. So make your customer a part of your organization and let them come be a part of what you do. And with that, I'll say, you know, let them be part of the process and go Hawks.
Well, I want to thank you all for this opportunity to be here and address you today. It's a great showing. It's great to see all the people out there. I hope that most of you are farmers, either aspiring or current. So we were asked to address certain questions, and one of them was finding and assessing market opportunities. And so I've just taken what my last few years of experience have brought me, and would just like to share some of that with you. One is the farm-to-table meetings. I think these are really important. Cascade Harvest Coalition has sponsored those throughout the state. When I was the small farm program coordinator at WSDA, we worked intimately with putting those programs together. They're still happening in most of the counties. One example would be the F2C2, which is the Farmer Fisher Chef Connection, which is more of a business-to-business opportunity, but it's where farmers and chefs come together, and that'll be happening in Seattle at the end of the month. And that's an annual event. This is, the eighth year, except they skipped last year. But any case, there are opportunities for farmers to reach out and find market potential that wasn't there previously before the idea of farm-to-table. So farm-to-table looks at institutional marketing opportunities as well as restaurants and so forth. So I think they're really great. Food hubs are an emerging sector, and NABC, where I work, the Northwest Agriculture Business Center, I noticed the slide said Agricultural Business Center, it's actually Agriculture Business Center, and I'm really happy to be there because we have lots of opportunity. We're working, putting together food hubs. Currently, this past season, we had a food hub at 21 Acres in Woodinville. We also had one at Bow Hill up in Skagit County, and the objective is to grow these food hubs so that there'll be links. So it's basically aggregation and distribution, and through a platform. We used a different platform last year. We have a new platform that we're introducing this year, and platform meaning that it's a way that institutions and large buyers can aggregate product. We keep it identity preserved, so you know what farm it's coming from, so you can actually place your order and order from a specific farm and get the product. And so there's a fresh sheet produced each week that would identify what's available from the farms. And we actually, in a first year, well, this is the second year somewhat, but it was really the first year of really driving this food hub concept. We had some orders that were well over $2,000 from several universities through the season. And we did, I think the numbers were approaching $100,000. I know we exceeded $80,000 for a first year effort, which is two hubs in activity or in action, was quite good. But now the objective is to grow that food hub concept. So we're hoping that, for example, Cloud Mountain Farm Center, which is a nonprofit center up in Whatcom County, would become the northernmost hub and then develop a hub we already have in Skagit County, we'll be developing further, and then one in Snohomish County, and again in King County, and try to link those together so that an institutional buyer could go to one source, place their order, have one invoice, and one delivery. And this is a gap that's been existent in direct marketing for a long time. So this is a very exciting opportunity. In addition, I think value added is an opportunity. For the past, well, the last year I was with, or last 2 years I was with the Department of Agriculture, actually was working on a specialty crop block grant and doing a series of value-added workshops across the state. In fact, I did the first one here in Puyallup across the street. And I traveled around the state, and they were four-week intensive classes where we helped teach people what it takes to do value-added. And more recently, I worked with Girish Ganjal, who is with WSU. He's a food scientist there and an engineer. And we just did a course up in Woodinville, I guess last week or week before, on product development for value added. And we're gonna repeat that class around several locations in the state. So I know it's scheduled for April 7th up at the research station in Skagit County, for example. So I think that value added is another opportunity for assessing markets. You know, agricultural products, as you all know, have seasonality, and if you can extend that season, if you can utilize the culls and seconds that you're producing and produce something that generates income for you, that's great value. Not a play on words, but you know, you actually are creating something of value that can help your bottom line. Another question that we were kind of asked to, well, I know I want to go back up just for a second. So in terms of value added, co-packing is really a crucial need in terms of infrastructure development. And so right now at NABC, we have what we're calling our processing initiative. And what we're hoping to do is work with a principal and develop a processing facility that would offer value-added co-packing capacity, as well as some larger commercial lines. So there's a number of different lines that we have proposed to producers to develop opportunities for value-added, including the larger commodity farms and then the smaller producers and mid-scale producers as well. So anyway, the other question we were asked is about business planning and marketing, and Don alluded already to the cultivating success classes. I think that WSU has a tremendous value in the community for farmers in terms of the cultivating success. So their initial class on beginning farmer rancher and then their follow-up class on ag entrepreneurs and business planning are really valuable resources. And I've had the benefit as being a guest lecturer at those for the last 8 years around the state, and I think that they're a great resource. In addition, NABC offers a TVA, which is transitioning to value added. And we have a whole series of classes. So we have classes on marketing and branding. We have classes that I mentioned, like product development for value added. We have classes on enterprise feasibility. It's a whole list. We helped develop, it was actually a specialty crop block grant to develop a culture for hard cider. And as a result of that, NABC has facilitated a Northwest Cider Association. I think there's 34 members now, including from BC all the way down to Oregon and in between. And so it's a significant culture now. So we're working, offering classes on both the business side of cider production and then also the production side of cider, growing the apples and actually producing the cider. So those are just some examples of what we do with our TVA, our Transition Value Added course. We have a whole course curriculum, so you can look that up online under NABC. One of the other things that I was asked to address was strategies for new markets. And, you know, I think that wholesale is really emerging. It used to be that small-scale farmers, mid-scale farmers even often didn't look at that market, or traditionally commodity farmers just looked at that market. And we know that direct marketing, shortening the supply chain, can have a significant impact on your income potential. But now, direct wholesale is becoming more and more available, both through the food hubs, which is definitely a direct wholesale shortening of that supply chain and leaving more in the farmer's pocket, I think is real significant. But we also have some of the industry starting to recognize the value of local food. And so doors have been opened. There's market chains and stores as big as Whole Foods that can actually do, you know, you could call it backdoor contracting. So they can actually buy direct. The managers of those larger kinds of retail outlets will offer opportunities for farmers to directly sell their product. And they also have grant loan programs to help farmers scale up to provide to those markets. We have lots of examples here in Washington of success along those lines. So that was, you know, wholesale, but direct market, clearly, you know about farmers markets. Really important. They haven't diminished in their importance. In fact, the State Farmers Market Association, I think it was last weekend, had their state meeting, which I think is kind of ironic. 8 years ago, almost to the week, the Washington State Farmers Market Association had their annual meeting right in this room, and it was my first day of employment at WSDA. So I was in this room and met several people that are now close friends and colleagues that I work with. But it was very special. But any case, farmers markets, CSAs, community supported agriculture, some of those concepts have really morphed. So some of our farmers markets are year-round now, and that's a really important marketing opportunity for growers. Many of them are doing, many growers are doing season extension with high tunnels and, you know, using technology to extend their season so they'll be able to provide product year-round, and that's creating that opportunity for the markets to operate year-round. Very important. In addition, CSAs have kind of morphed. You know, we have, well, an example you'll hear from the producer, you know, we have some farms that have gone to distribution businesses, and they're providing an opportunity for farmers to aggregate product and get into the marketplace through a CSA concept. Another thing along CSAs are workplace CSAs. I've been working with, for example, Sustainable Connections up in Whatcom County is developing a concept of workplace CSA. So there you have a body of buyers, consumers, that, am I going too long here? Is that? All right, sounds good. There's lots more, but I'm happy to share. I'll be around all day. Feel free to ask me questions, but thanks for the opportunity to be here.
So there is actually a wealth of information in these two human beings sitting here at this table, and so now I'd like to open it up for all of you to put questions to them. If you have questions about your own farm business and you want to access new markets, you know, what questions might you have for them? And I think we have one microphone in the middle of the room, so we'll have to ask people to go step up to the microphone if you have a specific question. You want to put your hands up and then we'll, yeah, go ahead.
Making small operations more economically viable, are there any incentives, state incentives, county incentives to, excuse me, for example, let's talk about solar energy, for instance. What kind of incentives exist to produce solar energy in an agricultural operation to improve opportunities for income as well as efficiency? So,
I know that USDA does have energy grants, and there are opportunities to look at that. I think also NRCS probably would have some programs. They actually do have a program on energy use or energy efficiencies. So I think it's an excellent question. I don't know anything at the state level specifically at all. Address your legislators, you know, convince them to put some kind of legislation in to get some funding for that. I think it's a great idea. It's certainly important. But we have done workshops. When I was with the state, we did a series of workshops on alternative energy on the farm. And you know, I think an example, well, 21 acres, they have a platinum LEED certified building and educational center. And, you know, there is an emphasis on energy conservation and energy efficiencies. But I just don't know of any state programs that are helping fund or support that kind of activity, more federal.
Well, I do know, for example, Europe's just eating our lunch in that,
that regard, just take a look and see what some of the incentives are in Great Britain, for example.
Right.
It's amazing.
Yeah, drop me your contact information and I'll find out who's doing that work within WSU and connect you.
Yeah. Is the Carbon Masters program still going?
Okay. Let me rephrase the question. I'm not sure everybody heard you over in this corner, but basically the question is about agritourism, having people on your farm for weddings and other special events, picnics, other activities. What's involved with that and what challenges might there be?
I also serve on the Skagit County Agricultural Advisory Board, and they make recommendations to the county commissioners. So this last year, the county passed a new ordinance for Skagit County that would allow up to 12 weddings or other events on a farm per year. Once you exceed that number, well, you're not allowed to exceed that number without proper permitting. So it seems to be working pretty good. I do not.
All right. We just re-looked at all of our agritourism regulations, and they did get approved. Unfortunately, they were tied in with some other regulations, and they're under appeal right now. Not that section, but it just got delayed in implementing. So we're hoping to have that through the appeal process down at the state and back in place by June. I don't know if it did 12 per site, but we did try to look at agritourism and improve that part of our code.
And not specific to Pierce County, because I'm not familiar with what the regulations might be, but just in general, agritourism is an important revenue stream for many farms, and there have been a series of workshops. I think, unfortunately, most of them were in Yakima over the last several years, but I just read, I think this morning, an email that in Kitsap County, I believe, there's going to be, Curtis Buse is coming there from Okanagan County, and to address the issue of agritourism, and he's very knowledgeable and should be very helpful.
We've got some information out on the table. Great. About that workshop, so it is coming up, and great. Cheryl, actually, wherever Cheryl is, it will be there, so if you've got a question about it, she can probably answer it for you.
Great.
We have a tree farm that's big trees, not Christmas trees, where you grow logs and so forth. And if I want to run cows in there for vegetation control, I'm constrained somewhat. And I'm curious, I attended an agroforestry conference at Wazoo, I don't know, 25, 30 years ago. And I was curious what sort of work is being done with agroforestry. I think there's 215,000 people in the state who own forest land of 2.5 acres or more. That's according to the Washington Technology Initiative. But I was just curious if you're aware of any agroforestry. They're great for cleaning weeds out of Christmas trees and so on and so forth, too.
Yeah, no, there's some great work being done. I know I'm an Oregon State University graduate, and I know they have a program where they're doing research on agroforestry, so you might look into that. Locally, you have access to Kevin Zobris, who runs the forestry program for the five-county region, and so I'd encourage you to get a hold of him, and he can get you. Yeah. Zobrist, and he's housed at WSU Snohomish County.
And then additionally along those lines, there has been some work with like doing value added with forest land. So growing mushrooms, for example, there's been some success in that many folks have pursued.
We've got time for a few more questions. Yes.
I was wondering, there are a lot of products that you can grow in Western Washington do well with our climatic conditions. And I was wondering if there's any resource that would forecast in light of climate change additional crops that aren't viable now, maybe in a few years or in next
year. Mr. Chad, do you want to talk?
The question is products that might become more favorably adapted to Western Washington with climate change. And the one that really comes to mind is the grape industry. They've already gone out and mapped what's going to happen if temperature raises a few degrees. And so they are very aware of what's going to take place should climate change increase at a rapid rate. And it's very exciting. You know, we get into some varietals that in this area that we traditionally can't grow. I don't know if many of you are involved in the grape industry, but traditionally we're kind of a Pinot Noir type varieties, and for me, it's not something that I really care to drink. They're very peppery in flavors and not something that I really prefer. However, as we start looking to Merlots, Syrah, some of these things that really are, you know, more warm season, we have a tremendous potential. So I'm excited about that for the future. And I get a lot of Debbie Downers about climate change, but I'm a proponent. I could go for a couple more degrees.
Is Center for Sustaining Ag and Natural Resources also doing work on climate change?
They are, yes.
And that's your Chad Kruger.
Chad Kruger's doing a
great
whole bunch
resource
of work for grains specifically.
Yeah.
While you wait for that hand mirror, I was just going to chime in on, it's interesting, Don and I carpooled down here from Skagit this morning, and we had this very discussion about climate change and how it's impacting. I just want to, you know, make mention that, you've all heard about the drought in California, and a third of the acreage isn't going to be planted this year. Well, that's potential opportunity for us. So again, I'm not a proponent of climate change, as Don would say, but I'm a proponent of some of the benefits that we can see in our agricultural production here, and we definitely are going to see an opportunity to fill in some of that gap because of that lost production down south.
We cut you off right when you were about to talk about workplace CSAs. Could you just give him a minute to tell us about that?
Thank you. Well, when I was with the state still, we introduced the concept of having CSA drop sites at state buildings. And we did a pilot project in Olympia the first year, and it was so successful that it spread so that state agencies could use, I don't know if you use state resources, but it could be a conduit for assisting to get CSA drop sites set up to access for state employees. So that was really beneficial. But the more current work that I've been involved in has been with a nonprofit that's called Sustainable Connections up in Bellingham, and also a nonprofit called Cloud Mountain Farm Center, which is in Whatcom County in Everson. And we actually are reaching out to workplaces and facilitating that same process that I mentioned that the state has been successful at. And so it's encouraging, speaking to the health, whatever you call them, not health advisor, but someone who is motivated to see a more healthy workplace and healthy employees. And there's a good linkage there.
Thank you. So let's give them a little round of applause. And I would like our local farmer panelists to please step forward. Dan Hulse from Tahoma Farms and Andy Wilcox from Wilcox Farms.
My name is Dan Hulse, and I guess I first just wanted to say thank you to the county executive and the committee and everybody else that sponsored this event. I think it's a really good opportunity for us to get together and talk about these important issues. Just to give you a little bit of background, my wife, Kim, who's here, she's a third generation resident of Pierce County in Tacoma. I myself graduated from the University of Puget Sound in 2002. We met at Terry's Berries Farm on River Road. And at the time, I was working for an organic produce wholesaler, and Kim was ready to start off on her own. So we leased a couple acres in Enumclaw. And at the time that we started out, we decided that one issue that we wanted to combat through the formation of our business was kind of the seasonality problem that we have here, opportunity, as it were, which was just that we would bring in organic produce. We figured that the same people that would be interested in eating locally also might tend to prefer organic. And so we started bringing in produce from California and working through the wholesaler that I was still employed with at the time. And since Fred talked a little bit about food hubs, and that's, kind of how our model has evolved to the point where we are aggregating product from a lot of other organic farmers in Washington State that will deliver to our warehouse in Tacoma. And then we have, primarily majority of our customers are retail. So we're doing home delivery to about 1,000 residents in King, Pierce, and Thurston counties right now. And that's a year-round program. So we, what started off with the digital equivalent of writing credit card numbers down on pieces of paper and sending out, you know, emails or posting flyers of, you know, this is what we're harvesting this week on our farm to, you know, where we are today in about the last 10 years. So there's sort of three topics that we were asked to address: market opportunities, business strategies, and that the transitions that your farm will need to make to meet the demands of a changing market. So I'm just got some notes here, and I just want to share my thoughts on these three topics. So from the bottom going up, transitions. So I think, you know, one of the first ones that came to mind is food safety. There's a great new creamery, thank you. Mountain Lodge Farm in Eatonville, and Sherwin Ferguson is one of the cheesemongers there. And her quote that sort of stuck with me from a year or two ago when she was first getting started and we had just started on, you know, in our farming operation, is that, you know, when the FDA is knocking at the front door, it is not the right time to be running out the back door. And I think that I know that it's a very contentious issue, and thankfully I think that the feds through the Food Safety Modernization Act, they are listening to consumer and producer comments, and they're taking our feedback and revising some of the rules that I think were of greatest concern to producers. But I think that it's an issue that just needs to be confronted on the farms. I mean, we had that family business in Colorado that, you know, they almost got sent to prison because they grew some tainted cantaloupe. And, you know, all they ended up with was a, you know, $15 million judgment against them or something like that. And it's a big, important issue. And it just, especially on the farm level, just need to have food safety plan. We've talked a little bit about technology. I just can't emphasize that one enough. It's a really, you know, disruptive sort of environment out there. The way that technology is moving so quickly, and it has the potential to disrupt traditional markets, getting the consumer to connect directly to the producer. You know, consumers, the young people. I can say that now because I'm, you know, 30, in my 30s. So the people younger than me are very savvy. They're always on the go. They're very mobile oriented. There's, you know, a new social media craze every 6 months or so. And if you don't know how to do that yourself, you should find somebody that does, that you can bring in and that's very familiar with that technology, because it's not going anywhere. And then another transition is just differentiation. You know, it is competitive landscape in the market these days, and we all can do a better job at telling our story. You know, what, just trying to be the most authentic that we can, offering a high level of transparency is something that people are looking for. So those are a couple transitions. Business strategies. This is, you know, I noticed when Don and Fred were talking, I just knew there was gonna be a lot of overlap. So one favorite quote that I've heard recently: do you sell what you grow, or do you grow what you can sell? So it's possible to open up a seed catalog or a nursery catalog, and you know, I have this desire too. Is I'm gonna do fruit trees, I'm gonna do chickens, I'm gonna do everything just because I can. But if you actually have a product that that's already sold, that you have the market for, that's the best product that you can actually grow. For CSAs and other, you know, kind of direct marketing outlets like that, I heard recently that from an insider that the average retention rate is about 50%. so we can collectively do a better job of keeping those customers that we have. Making, you know, again, this is the differentiation and being, you know, authentic and giving them those experiences that they're not going to get otherwise at a big box store. The farm, what I consider to kind of be a farmer or ag specific reality of finance is that we tend to have higher, you know, debt to asset ratios. We tend to have maybe trouble finding traditional lenders that want to invest or make loans in our businesses. But I feel like there are a lot of resources out there, and they're just maybe a little bit harder to access. But you know, the Farm Service Agency, we recently got through their microloan program, we got a $25,000 loan at 1.5% to construct an automated wash line for our root crops, which is gonna just make us tremendously more efficient and profitable. And it's well worth the money and the time and energy to go through these types of programs. Farm Credit, you know, Northwest Farm Credit Services, they're a lending agency that's really familiar with our with what we do. Then a couple other things I'll get to later, hopefully. But market opportunities, the value-added producer grant is something that, you know, I think there's got to be somebody in this room that can. Can make a successful proposal or business plan that could really access some of these monies through the federal grant process. The farm bill that just got passed, it actually, you know, it did some bad things. It cut conservation, it cut food stamps, but it did restore funding to the organic certification cost share program. There's a new veterans program that's encouraging veterans to go into agriculture. The beginning farmer and rancher program was reauthorized. I think that off season, you know, the value, again, value added, what can you, if can you do anything indoor, either with hydroponics or aquaponics? And basically the demand for local products is insatiable. I mean, it's people just really want to be able to eat locally year round, and our challenge is to allow them to do that, to help them in doing that. And I think that collaboration is a real important market opportunity. So I guess along the idea of food hubs, but that there's, you know, strength in numbers, and there's a lot of people in this room that are doing great things. And if you can band together, I mean, I remember Holly Foster, who's back there, you know, 10 years ago, sitting at her farm after a long day in the field, drinking a beer, and she said, "Why are we always competing against each other? You know, if we would just cooperate, it would be so much more easy." And there's a lot of truth to that. You know, if we can well, you're good at growing this, and I'm good at growing this. Let's grow, you know, let's share what we're growing and market it together. And finally, you know, there's a statistic that about 1% of the population goes out of their way to access food directly from the producer. That means that there's a 99% market opportunity out there. And I think that honestly, like, that's where policymakers and the nonprofits you know, that there's a real chance there for innovation, especially in transition or succession planning. You know, we have a lot of established farmers with a lot of acreage in their businesses that there's a market opportunity there to create the model or the structure that's going to allow them to retire, you know, get a fair value for what they've built up, and then also to usher in this new generation of producers that that we know that we need. And I'll leave it at that.
My name's Andy Wilcox. I'm fourth generation farmer with Wilcox Farms. Our family is in the egg business primarily. We do shell eggs, liquid eggs for food service, and now are doing hard-boiled eggs in 2-packs and 12-packs. And for us, you know, I'm going to talk mainly today is value added. In our company, in 2006, we decided to get out of the dairy business and focus primarily on our egg business. And it was given to my brother and cousin and I. Really, my dad said, and uncle said, it's up to you. Do you want to continue the farm? And we had experienced the commodity business. And in that situation, you know, you're just constantly, how do you lower costs? How do you take, you couldn't treat the environment well. You couldn't treat your employees well. It was just, it wasn't a fun environment. It's nothing you could be proud of. And so what my brother and cousin and I just said, hey, if we're going to do this, we're going to do this with something and really model something that we can really be proud of and develop products that we could. And for us, that was converting over to cage-free and organic egg production. Currently, we're about 40% there since our farm is about 40% converted. And then our goal is to convert 10% a year. And so it's been extremely successful, and I don't think we'd still be farming unless we had organics or cage-free, that whole marketplace. I don't think our farm would survive today if that market wasn't there. I think the biggest keys, you know, when I think back kind of what made our transition successful, I think the first thing is really balancing between understanding your customer and marketing well and doing what the customer attributes are. But you also have to balance that with, you need to have your own defined ideas about production and really believe in it and really think through what your organic or your cage, for us in livestock, is how do we want our animals treated and what's the best feed, and have those beliefs as well. Because if you just, all you do is just go after that consumer market and constantly chasing, you'll find, and you see a lot of the bigger companies in organics, it turns into greenwashing. And so you really have to, but on the same token, I see a lot of farmers that say, well, I've got my thing and I'm just gonna produce them forever, and then nobody wants to buy it. So it's really that balance. If you just, you can't get too far into marketing, or else you'll, you know, there's some negatives there, but you also have to just do that really nice balance. The other thing I think that was made us successful in converting over to cage-free and organics is when we started in 2006, I developed a 5-year plan. And we're nowhere close to what that 5-year plan was. And I think that's what most people say, is your plans are never close. But it really helped us kind of understand the future and then what some of the biggest challenges, and especially the financing and the cash flows and those. But just, it really gives you kind of a... And I know, because we're still constantly, every day, like today, there's so much going on today that I couldn't get away to do, you know, even coming here today, I was just like going, can I even come? And there's so many pressures, especially in farming, day after day. But you have to figure out, if you really want to get to where you want to be, you have to find that time to do that long-term planning. And the way I do it, and I think our company too, one of the things that we chose, we wanted to be in the highest end. And I mean, this is just a business philosophy, but if you look into most industries, the highest end usually has the highest correlation of profits. And so I think, especially here in the Pierce County area, and we're not trying to be huge economies of scale and different things, that's my suggestion, is you look, whatever you're growing or whatever you're raising, try to be in the highest end of whatever that industry segment is. But the way I look at it is, I look out 3 or 4 or 5 years, is for our chickens, how can I produce the most awesome egg from both an animal welfare, these birds have the best living conditions, and then that egg, how does it have the best micronutrients, best healthiness for the person that you're doing it? There's no way you can do that in 6 months. But you look out like 5 years out in advance, and then you just say, hey, incrementally, I'm gonna make these improvements. And that's the one thing I've just seen, is even though you say, man, that's gonna add so much extra cost to it, what we're finding is people are buying it. And you have to have that plan, though, to get there. there's really what I find is the when you people that I know that try to do things within 2 or 3 months, and especially as you get into organics, it's a very long-term process. You have to build the infrastructure, but it's, and you get overwhelmed, but if you just take the time and the patience, you can develop those things. The other thing I would just say is organics, at least in our industry, but a lot of other people, it's, I mean, there is a huge marketplace there. And for our company, I think one of the best advantages that we have, our main competitors are actually in the Midwest or Eastern Washington. And one of our best advantages is just living here in Western Washington. I'm in tune with the customers. And I think if we think about that here in Pierce County, you're in tune with this customer base. And the other cool thing as far as where we've been able to expand and scalable, if you think about the Portland, Puget Sound marketplace, and then Northern California with that population base, this is probably the largest organic natural food population base in the world if you take all three of those population centers together. So, you know, a lot of people like Eastern Washington are so focused on, you know, exporting, you know, internationally and different things like that. There's this huge base that you can have this niche and you can just focus in on, you know, Puget Sound, Portland, and Northern California. The other thing, you know, and my advice, if we primarily focus in retail and then like distributors and different things, where we've had success is obviously organics and getting an organic certification has been, and it's challenging, you look at it, but you just, once you just start diving in, do test plots or do test barns or something like that, you get used to it and then it's easy to expand out of that. But there's other certifications. We do humane farm certification, and that really, if you're into livestock, that's probably the best. It's really recognized, and I know that's great because auditors come and they make us change things. And you know that you're getting a good certification when they're very tough on you. But it's the best, I believe, in animal welfare. The other one is Food Alliance. Does a great job as far as doing kind of an overall farming picture, and then Salmon Safe. But if you're trying to get into retail, what these certifications do is it really just legitimizes your product. And I know, again, it's just like organics. Man, all that bureaucracy, all this extra things. But you got to look, it's not, what we look at certifications is they're great marketing. And not every retailer, not every distributor or customer wants that. But it's just weird. That's why we have like 4 or 5 different certifications, because it's like the UC schools, they want a certain certification. Another customer, they want a different certification, but it's a great way for you to find a niche to get into a certain marketplace. The other thing that I've found too is, like, we work with the regulator, you know, DOE, and working on our farm and all the farming practices, and I think our Salmon Safe certification is a great story with that. Rather than fighting, we had an old farm manager like 20 years ago, and he was like, oh, I hate DOE, and it's just all about fighting them. And then my cousin took over, and he's just embraced it. And then instead of fighting, we're just trying to improve upon things and building it. And then we got the Salmon Safe certification. And then rather than, it's really been a positive. And the reality is, just following the DOE regulations, a lot of what you're doing there, you're already able to get one of these certifications. And then you're able to promote your business in that way. So, I mean, there's ways, these regulatory things are very tough and hard to do, but maybe try to figure out a way that you can market that and get some extra marketing out of it. And it goes for quality too. There's lots of really good quality certifications. If there's a way that you can, when you're doing all this stuff, if there's a way to market it, you're spending all the money anyways, how do you market that to get advantage of that? And, you know, the only thing I would just say is the toughest thing in Pierce County to farming, we've really tried to expand our wheat production, and we want to try to find feedstuffs locally, both in Lewis County and Pierce County, to feed our chickens. Because not only locally chickens, but if you think of how much feed we feed our chickens, it's like thousands of acres. And I think the biggest thing is I talked to my uncle, who used to be in farming here, is the infrastructure has just gone away. And I think that's where, on a long-term basis, working with you know, the government and different people to really make it successful back to getting into farming. Like, we're just trying to find, there's not a John Deere dealer to, you know, work on a combine or something like that. You know, there's one in Lewis County, but just those little things make it so much tougher in Pierce County versus even Skagit County or Lewis County. So that's it for me.
Thank you both. That was great. We'll open it up for some questions, and then Don and Fred B. Yes, please use the mic. Come on up.
Dan, I'm with the City of Ordingham. We've just been trying to figure out for some time now, how can we partner with the farms in our region there in the Ording Valley?
We farm in Ording, right? I mean, we have a farm on Orville Road, and the thing that brings people to Ording is the Foothills Trail, and I think that people are looking for the recreational opportunities that can coexist with our ag businesses and farms. And if you can create a link between what it is that brings people out, you know, the trail, for instance, and the farms in the area, I think that's the ticket.
I'm Julie Boggs, and I'm actually from Jefferson County, but I'm on the Puget Sound Meat Producers Cooperative. And I did bring some flyers here today, but one of the issues we have is we are managing the Pierce County mobile slaughter trailer. And one of the largest obstacles we've had is to try to find a suitable harvest site in Pierce County. And so if there's anyone that is willing and has a site that would work, we'd certainly like to hear from them. And so if we have flyers or talk to me on how to get a hold of us. So if you have any answers to any of that as far as or thoughts, how do you harvest your chickens?
I see people pointing fingers at themselves back there. So I think you should go talk to them.
Oh, they can talk to me.
And make sure you write that down as a question, and there may be some role that the county can play in that as well.
Thank you.
Other questions? Yes.
This is just a thought question for you all. Would you see any value in on-site testing? And you talked about food safety being the regulations concerning certifying that the food is safe. Is there any value, in your opinion, if the technology existed, for doing on-site testing to certify the safety of the food?
Well, we actually use WSU here, the Avian Food Lab. So any of our products, our hard-boiled and liquid egg products, we test for salmonella, E. coli, and listeria, and put it on hold in inventory before we release anything out to the public. And then they get test results back to us in 27 hours. So that's been a great item for us. I think the challenges, some of the other, like I know even we started testing for non-GMO and different things, like for crops and different things currently. It's just very, some of the testing, like on the food safety side, that's really expensive, and then the timing isn't, the time from, because they're perishable products a lot of times, the time you're getting the test results back versus the time you're trying to go to market generally isn't possible. When you look at most of the food safety programs though, I think that rather than working on the back end, I think really, like, the FDA has started to regulate egg production now, and the reality is a lot of people were really negative about it, but if you think through the program in itself, it's mostly preventative measure programs, and the reality, at least from my standpoint, if you're complying with those preventative maintenance or preventative areas, you're really producing a safe product in that sense.
Yeah, and I would just add on that there are a lot of existing private companies that are doing the testing that I think that we would need on our farm, and the auditing process is already in place using WSU or WSDA. But I think that kind of talking more broadly about the infrastructure and the grower services
I think that's an area where we certainly could use a lot of help with manufacturing of new pieces of equipment. You know, there's a lot of small farms out there that are using equipment from the 1940s or from Italy. Why can't we, reinforce another industry in our community that could be building those products or dealing with pest control, thought about other auxiliary services that do support the farming community.
Yeah, stand up.
Dan, you spoke a little bit about the technology, and I've actually been on your website, and it's really good. So I was just wondering if you could explain, did you build it yourself? Did you use like a third party? And then kind of the costs that were associated with it.
Yeah, so we use a platform called Farmigo, which is farm and amigo in one, Farmigo. And there's a few of these services out there that, ours, it's just based, there's not a flat upfront cost. We just pay a percentage of sales to them. So we look at it as a transaction fee, just like a credit card processor is gonna take 2%. Well, Farmigo takes 3%. So there are some options out there. They're all kind of based on, the CSA subscription model. We had to do a little bit of fine tuning for it to fit with our model. But something was really revealing to me 5 years ago when we were looking for a developer. We thought we needed a custom software solution, and we were told by someone working close with Microsoft that you think you're in the farming and the delivery business, but really you're in the data management business. And that was very eye-opening because without the right technology, we wouldn't be able to scale like we are today, and we wouldn't be able to offer our customers, the nice, easy-to-use interface and remove a lot of those barriers, that exist in traditional transactions. That's something that's just becoming obsolete and outdated. People don't, carry checkbooks around anymore. Like, got to figure a way around that. So.
Any other questions?
Could you have Andy explain how you peel hard-boiled eggs 1,000 at a time? Or
you want to repeat the question, Andy?
It's just like you at home, just on a huge scale, basically. But equipment from Europe, basically, kind of like you were mentioning, but equipment from Europe and it uses kind of a pressure and wash. But the key is actually for you guys at home, the whole key to hard-boiled eggs and get the peel, the shell off, is you actually want to temper the egg at room temperature for a day. That makes all the difference in the world. So that's the little secret there.
Any other questions? If Don and Fred could come up, we'll have everybody all together.
Since it goes through a hard-boiled egg process, it's just different. At a certain point in time, it hits a temperature that you're killing pathogens. So you do have, the FDA gives this kind of window of 36 hours. So 36, from the time that a chicken lays an egg, you have 36 hours basically before it needs to get into refrigeration.
Mm. And once it's in refrigeration, does it need to stay in refrigeration? You couldn't pull it back out and then boil
it. It needs to stay. Okay. Yeah.
We've all learned something. So now is your opportunity to have all these great ag experts up here, both the producers and the guys that are out there helping the producers every day with your questions. There's a silence. Oh, it's Cheryl. Hi, Cheryl.
Fred, glad to see you back in
a stable situation. So all of your major experience in chicken processing, are you able to continue to be an asset on that in your new position, or is that tabled and somebody else is taking that on?
Cheryl, I think someone must have had you ask that question. You were paid to ask a question. Because something I wanted to share on this.
I'm a farmer, I never get paid, okay.
Right. On the issue of infrastructure, I am very excited to let you know that NABC recently received a grant, and it means that a project that I've been working on probably for more than 10 years, but specifically for the last 4 or 5 months, we will now have a mobile poultry processing unit that will be state-of-the-art and unique to anywhere in the world that I'm aware of. There exists mobile poultry processing unit, but nothing like the one that we've just designed, and it's currently in line to be built. And so the infrastructure will be there. So for those of you that are poultry producers, the barrier to the market has been access to processing, and now processing will be available shortly. And I'm excited to share that information.
So the Pierce Conservation District does have poultry processing equipment for rent for your use. So file that away if you're interested in processing chickens.
I have another question.
Yes.
Full of them today. No. The mobile slaughtering unit for Pierce County, what's the status of that? I'm just curious because it was brought up, I think, a second ago, and I'm just not sure where it is today and how it's being utilized.
Yes, the mobile slaughter trailer is being used on a regular basis, 2 days a week. It's regularly scheduled for, it's in Port Orchard on Tuesdays and in McKenna on Thursdays. And we're still looking for a suitable site in Pierce County. And we're also looking into one at this time in King County. Occasionally it has gone to Clallam County. There's a site that occasionally is allowable, but has been approved by USDA. But it is working on a regular basis, has been in the, you know, making some money finally to make improvements on it, to keep it on going. But it's really a large facility to maneuver around, as much as, of course, we'd hope to have it in the beginning. But it's been very successful. The meats are delivered to Minder Meats in Bremerton and Heritage Meats in Rochester this time. Those are USDA processing plants. Any other questions?
So just a kind of a regulatory hurdle then, in terms of finding a USDA like slaughter site?
Yeah, we have to have humane handling facilities and places for the offfall and water. Those are the main things that, but I did bring some brochures that are on the table for anyone who's interested to find out more about it. Annual meeting for the Puget Sound Meat Producers Cooperative is going to be on March 9th in Tacoma here. I can't remember exactly, but you can find out the information with the pamphlet there, a website. So, any other questions about it? Thank you.
The question I have, with land prices being so high and taxes, operating costs, equipment costs, what type of farming operation is viable, say for a 5-acre parcel or a 10-acre parcel or a 15-acre parcel? An operation that would be viable on 20 or 100 or 200 acres won't work on 10. And where can a young person go to get the guidance to let them know, you know, your plan is not going to work, you don't have enough land, you don't have the resources, you're not going to be successful, and here's an idea of what would work for you.
I'll share. That's fine. So we as WSU educators can't be proponents of marijuana because we receive
funding from the federal government, and they frown on it. So unfortunately, we can't give that information. One that I'm really excited about now, and I hate to make recommendations because when I first started my position back in 2006, it was organic blueberries, and everybody was going to get rich on organic blueberries. And as you know, everybody got into blueberries, the market declined, and then we got this nasty little insect called spotted wing Drosophila, which also has inflicted its own sorts of pain. So the one that I'm really liking right now is cider apples. It's something that is really coming on. There's a huge trend that there's going to be this huge need in the future. I also like it from the standpoint of you can harvest a lot of apples, these small European varieties of apples, and you can do it mechanically. And so the contact for that particular project is Dr. Carol Miles. She's at WSU Northwest Rec in Mount Vernon, and she has a trial established for these particular cider apples that she's harvesting with an old raspberry harvester. She's taking, you know, basically 5 pounds of these apples and creating a nice bottle of cider, and that cider will market anywhere around $20. So, yeah, it's hard cider. Yeah, yeah. It's similar to wine.
Well, yeah. There's both at 7, or below 7, and yeah. above 7. Yeah. Has different regulatory environment, different yeah. labeling requirements, yeah. but both are really popular in the marketplace, and it's a growing culture.
Yeah, and NABC also does a course on it as well, so. There's another good contact for you.
There are a number of other resources available. Sarah Wilcox is here, and who has run our FarmLink program for the last several years. So that's another opportunity to provide technical assistance and one-on-one, a lot of hand-holding with beginning farmers in terms of what resources are available, what's feasible in terms of a farm operation, and all the resources that you need to get. So we partner quite extensively with WSU Extension and Cultivating Success, as well as some other programs around the state. So there are a number of resources available.
Mary, I'd just like to address that gentleman's question okay. from the standpoint of training opportunities. There's an internship program at Cloud Mountain Farm Center. There's the internship program essentially at the Viva Farms, and then also at the Greenbank Farm on Whidbey Island. And ultimately, I think there's been discussion anyway in Jefferson County. Well, the field program, I'm very familiar with the field program, but also a farm-based program as well, if they get that property, I think, on Maristone. But anyway, the point being that there are programs out there that young people that are interested in getting to farming can avail. And then speaking of young farmers, there is an organization of young farmers that is very effective, that does a lot of networking and self-help, you know, within that community. So, you know, someone mentioned competition, and there's, I think Dan mentioned competition, and there's something called coopetition. So it's recognizing that, you know, a rising tide floats all ships. And so by not looking at someone who's trying to do the same thing as you as competition, but realizing that you can lend resource to each other and assist each other, and that can be very beneficial. So really, to answer your question about, you know, 5-acre, 10-acre parcels, we have quite a few direct market farmers that are making a significant income from doing that. It's a lot of hard work and a lot of investment of time and energy, but they've done the due diligence to learn, and they're working hard at it, and many of them are successful at it. So
thank you all. This is a perfect segue into the break.